Hello everyone and welcome to episode number 52 of Get Real with Rajiv. This means we've officially completed 1 year of Get Real with Rajiv with an episode every single week. So I want to thank you firstly on this completion of 1 year of Get Real with Rajiv. Like every single episode, we're going to be answering 4 questions and today Bhakti is going to be the voice of your questions. So Bhakti, what's the first question?
Our first question is from Mangesh. Even after paying a good salary and periodic increments and a good working environment, employee attrition is high. Especially freshers tend to take training, learn and leave the company within 1 to 2 years. How can we solve this problem? How can we engage employees positively?
Well, Mangesh, firstly, thank you for that question. Retention is a result of multiple factors. So if you want to retain talent, there are multiple factors that need to be working for you and not against you so that you can retain talent. The first factor really is how much of a personal connect do you have to your employees. Now, I know some large SME owners, they tell me, Rajiv, there are so many team members, I can't have a personal connect with each and every person. Well, I agree you may not have a personal connect with each and every person when you have 100, 200, 300 people, but you need to have a personal connect with your managers and your managers need to have a personal connect with their team members. At every layer of the organization, the energy needs to flow seamlessly from top to bottom. And what do I mean by personal connection? Do you know the personal goals and aspirations of your team members? Have you aligned their personal goals and aspirations with the roles that they play in the organization and the career growth path that you're creating for them within the organization? Because if you're not doing that, expecting people to stay back or stay long in their workplace is just a wishful thought then. So the key really, Mangesh, is to ask yourself, do I know the goals of my team members? And I'm talking about personal goals of my team members. Have I shown them how the business is going to support in them achieving their personal goals? It could be career growth goals. It could be financial growth goals. It could be learning goals. It could be career aspiration goals that people may have. And if that is not there, then please understand words like engagement are just nice words thrown around in HR conferences, which nobody really understands or applies on the ground. So I would say retention is a result of engagement and engagement is a result of understanding the goals of your people and tying up those goals with their roles and with their journey in the organization. That's the best way to retain employees. Your specific question around freshers and how do you retain freshers? Firstly, I believe every organization, every entrepreneur needs to go in with the mindset in hiring that people will not last forever. When you go in with that mindset that people will not last forever, you don't really feel frustrated or irritated when people leave. Think about it. Nowadays, marriages don't last, leave alone team members lasting. Nowadays, your children don't grow up and live with you. So don't expect team members to live with you forever. Having said that, if you have an above normal attrition rate, you definitely have to be concerned about the quality of leadership that is being provided to people. You definitely have to be concerned about the quality of hiring. And in the quality of hiring, you need to evaluate what kind of psychographic profile is required for an ideal candidate who will last at least for the minimum number of years you would expect a candidate to work with you. So I see there are gaps in hiring there. You may be probably hiring students as freshers from tier A colleges, and some of these tier A college students treat their first job more like a springboard, a stepping stone, and they definitely don't look at long-term careers. I don't want to generalize, but you need to also be aware to what kind of economic background, social background are you hiring people from, because all of this has an influence on the personal aspirations they carry. And if their personal aspirations are not in alignment with your organizational aspirations, then you're hiring misfits essentially. So make these slight corrections and I hope, Mangesh, you will be able to take the engagement and the retention level with your employees to the next level. With that, let's move to the second question for the week. What's the second question, Bhakti?
Our second question is from Ankita. I would like to know, how do we control our thoughts? I want to do so many things for my business. There is so much in my head that I end up doing nothing. How do I overcome this?
So Ankita, basically you're suffering from a disease called analysis paralysis. There are so many things you're analyzing that the body is getting paralyzed and you're not taking action. So the simplest way to uncomplicate this cloud and clutter in your head is to write down your goals first. At the end of the day, please understand this. If you do not have clear goals, you do not have a direction to take. Goals give us direction. So make sure first you have written goals. From those written goals, break it down into strategies. Break it down further into to achieve those goals. What are the things that need to happen in your business, in every single department of your business? What needs to happen in marketing? What needs to happen in sales? What needs to happen in operations? What needs to happen in accounts, in human resources, R&D, and in management? So start with goals. Break it down into milestones that have to be achieved within these departments so that those goals turn into a reality. And then further break down these functional milestones into team goals. What is the capacity of team you need? What is the number of people you need? What is the skill and knowledge those people should have? So what's the competence of the people that, what type of competence should people have? So once you break it down from financial goals to say functional goals to then team goals in terms of capacity, competence and culture, then you will know what do you need to do as a next step to move in this direction of making sure that you have the right type of team, the right type of functional strategies and systems, which will by default produce the right type of result for yourself. So start with written goals, break it down and take it one step at a time. The most important thing that one has to keep in mind while taking action, and as an entrepreneur, it can get overwhelming because you are doing so many things, is to ask yourself, what is the most important thing I need to do today which will move me towards my goals? So every action that you're taking, every time you're spending time on something, do this little self-awareness check with yourself saying, is what I am doing today helping me move towards my goals or not? And if you think it is not helping you move towards your goal, then it means that you need to delegate it to somebody else, or you need to delay this activity, or you need to delete this activity, or you need to defer it to some other time. So you need to be very, very watchful about where you're spending your time. And when you start becoming conscious about that and you start getting clear about the direction of your business, I'm sure all that clutter will then flow like a seamless stream for you, Ankita. I hope that makes sense. With that, let's move to the third question for the week.
Our third question is from Anand. We are trying to build a sales team and we are failing in it consistently. We are targeting B2B customers and have never been able to develop a salesperson who can sell without us. How do we deal with this?
Well, Anand, I would say that in a B2B environment, this is probably one of the most difficult, yet one of the most critical milestones to achieve as a business owner. Which means the ability to build a salesperson who can go out there, network without you, present without you, negotiate without you, close deals without you, and bring business without you is like a dream come true for any B2B entrepreneur. And that's why I said it's the most critical and yet one of the most difficult facets of a B2B environment. Having said that, here is what I would recommend. I believe in a B2B business where you're targeting B2B customers, if you are the only salesperson for your business, that's the most damaging thing that can happen to your business. Because think about it, you will never be consistent in your effort, in your activity to reach out to a certain number of clients and have a certain number of meetings every week and every month, because you're involved in way too many things within your business. So when you're looking at building a sales department in a B2B environment, you need to look at two types of salespeople, and you can start with the first type. The first type is called a door opener. Who is a door opener? This is where you're hiring somebody who comes with a decent level of communication skills, selling skills, may not be that big an expert in terms of technical skills, or may not come with a ready network for themselves. But this person's job, like the name suggests, is a door opener. Their job is to make sure that the consistency of activity is high. Which means the number of meetings they are doing as a door opener, the number of doors they are opening for you as a business, where they're going and meeting decision makers and going and doing an introductory meeting, understanding the requirements of how that customer procures your products or services and giving a basic presentation on the background of your company. That's the job of the door opener. Consistency of activity. Do 5 meetings, 10 meetings, 15 meetings per week, or 30, 40 meetings in a month. Now this makes sure that you are constantly reaching out in the market to prospect customers, making them aware of your existence, gathering data of the type of requirements they have, building that intelligence for yourself, so that then you can jump in and intervene when the iron is hot or when the requirement is hot, and go out there and pitch the product or service proactively to those clients and close the deal. So the job of the door opener, like the name suggests, is to open doors. Very required for every B2B entrepreneur to have door openers in their sales team, because that's ensuring the consistency of activity. The second type of salespeople you need to hire in and develop in a B2B sales environment is what I call a deal closer. Now, the deal closer is an experienced salesperson, typically comes with a ready network, has had a track record of producing results and closing deals in your industry or domain. So they have the network, they have the expertise, they have the track record of results. Typically, this kind of a person comes at a high price, right? So I would say that when you are initially looking at building a sales team, if you have the financial resources with you, invest in a deal closer. Hiring a deal closer, somebody who has already done sales in the same industry to the same target audience and has a track record of results. If not, if you do not have the financial resources to invest in a deal closer, then at least get a door opener. So there's consistency of activity of sales, so that they are sowing the seeds and they're finding out the information, and you can go nurture the seed at the right time with the right person. So that's the approach to use. And from a skill point of view, if you want to understand how do you replicate that capability within your sales team in a sales in a B2B environment, one of the most important approaches I use to build people is called shadowing, where when you hire a salesperson, you take them along with you for 20-30 meetings where you are doing the meeting and they are watching. Then you go for 20-30 meetings where they are doing part of the meeting, you are doing part of the meeting, and finally you go on 20-30 meetings where they are doing the meeting and you are going there as a silent observer and watching. Now, this may sound like a tedious process, and I know a lot of entrepreneurs who may probably do phase one of them doing the meeting to showcase to their team members, or do phase two of doing meetings partly where the team member does a meeting and partly where the business owner does a meeting. Most entrepreneurs do phase one and phase two, but they hate phase three, because in phase three, the team member is talking and they have to shut up and be a silent observer. And this is where they cringe. This is where they feel like killing themselves based on what that person is talking in a meeting. And this is where I think patience is required to let people fail and then give them feedback meeting after meeting and really handcraft salespeople. So the best way of building a sales team is build them one at a time and give them all your attention and focus and chisel their capabilities and skill set. So it's a process in a B2B environment to replicate yourself in the sales department and build a salesperson who can do what you do. But I think it's definitely an activity every B2B entrepreneur should focus on as a high priority, because once you've built a salesperson who can replace you in sales in a B2B environment, then life is good. Then you've cracked the formula of scaling your sales. So I hope all of these inputs help you, Anand. With that, let's go to the fourth and final question for this week's episode. So Bhakti, what's the fourth question?
Our final question is from Arya. As the second generation of the family business, what is the best way for me to start understanding and working in the business?
Thank you so much, Arya, for that question. I would say that's a brilliant question. And here is the recommendation I would have, Arya. If you are entering the family business, one of the biggest mistakes family business owners make is that when their children join the business, they directly elevate those children to management positions within the business, give them an independent cabin, call them vice president or director or whatever. And I think that's a huge crime, because you're not just doing injustice to your employees by giving them a leader who's coming in with entitlement, but you're also doing injustice to your kids' career and their journey, because they have not earned their space. They have not risen from the ground. And that makes it a very, very weak proposition for the future of the business. So my recommendation to every family business owner and every second generation entrepreneur who's joining their parents' business is start from the scratch. Give yourself the first 2 to 4 years to work in every single department of the business for a minimum of 3 months to 6 months. Why? Because I believe it is important for you to work on the ground in every single department of the business, at least for 2 to 3 to 6 months, to understand the ground level functioning of that department. You cannot fly a plane if you don't know how to take it off from the runway. So you can't just sit in a plane at 30,000 feet height and say, okay, now I can fly the plane. You got to take it off the runway. So spend time in learning. And when you're joining every department, when you're switching departments, say you're spending 3 to 6 months in each department, give yourself those 3 years, like I said, first point. Secondly, when you're joining that department, please know that people will have that notion that you're the boss's son or the boss's daughter. And it is your responsibility to earn the place in people's heart. And the best way to earn place in people's heart is in those initial days of working, be a listener, be an observer, be a seeker, ask questions to learn. Don't go in there like, I'm the boss's son or I'm the boss's daughter and I will tell you guys what needs to happen. Even if you are intelligent, even if you come from an academic background where you're well trained, first get people's heart before you start applying your head. So be a listener, be an observer, be a seeker. Over a period of a month, month and a half, then become a co-creator. Become a brainstormer. Engage people with questions to co-create and brainstorm. And then towards the last couple of months in that department, then start demonstrating leadership. Then start giving inputs. Then start giving feedback. Then start appreciating people. So transition through these phases in every single department. Earn your respect with every single department. Earn the skills and knowledge of every single department. And then after 3 or 4 years of doing this in every single department, you may deserve that chair next to your mom or your dad or whoever in your family started that business. Till then, do not just take that seat and call yourself director because you are ready for marriage and you have to have a good profile. That's a request to every family business and every second generation entrepreneur. I hope that makes sense. So with that, we've come to the end of episode number 52 of Get Real with Rajiv. I want to say a big thank you to each and every one of you. Again, with this episode, we've completed 1 year of the Get Real with Rajiv series. And I'm going to ask you to do what I ask you to do every single time. Send in your questions in the comment section below or on the WhatsApp number that you see here so that we have more questions to answer to more people, and share this video with more people so that they get the exposure to this series called Get Real with Rajiv, where I give out answers to your questions. With that, this is Rajiv Talreja signing off. I look forward to seeing you in my next episode.